My name is Amy Snyder, and I'm 27 years old. I reside with my father and mother. Our family has always stuck together as a trio since my early years. Growing up, I've always admired my dad. He's the epitome of hard work, running his own bustling business. Though his schedule keeps him away from home most of the time, whenever he finds a moment, he dedicates it to me. On his off days, he prioritizes spending time with me, proving himself to be an exceptional father. My mom, however, paints a different picture. As far back as I can recall, she has never been employed. While she tends to household matters, she's never lent support to my dad's business or pursued a career outside our home. Despite our comfortable lifestyle, with my mom often seen socializing and attending events, her lack of involvement in my life has left me feeling somewhat neglected. There were moments of profound loneliness, but my dad's unwavering presence always filled that void. He understood the indifference my mom held towards me and made it his mission to ensure I never felt neglected or alone. As I grew older, my mother's tendency to break promises became apparent. While my dad's commitments were steadfast, my mother's casual approach to promises left me disillusioned. I learned not to hold her pledges in high regard. Conversely, my dad's reliability and trustworthiness garnered my admiration. I even entertained thoughts of joining his company after graduating from university. Being the only child, I saw it as a way to honor my father's legacy and continue his work. Upon reaching my 20s, my father began imparting invaluable wisdom during our outings for drinks. Meanwhile, my mother's involvement in my life remained superficial. The only time she interjected was during my sophomore year of college when I expressed my desire to join my father's company. "Dad, I want to work at your company after graduation. I'm already preparing for it. I want to follow in your footsteps someday," I announced eagerly. "Amy, are you sure about that?" "A girl doesn't need to pursue such endeavors," my mother intervened, her words dripping with traditional expectations. "Why not? I want to work hard like Dad," I insisted. "A woman should find a good man and let her husband provide for her," she countered, echoing typical sentiments. Disheartened by her lack of understanding, I chose not to engage further. I refused to live a life tethered to someone else's ambitions, mirroring my mother's existence. I had always aspired to become an independent woman, determined to navigate through my college years on my own terms. After that pivotal moment, I dedicated myself to diligent study, paving the path to join my father's company immediately after graduation. Though my mother remained unconvinced, it seemed she eventually resigned herself to my decision. "If you choose to live this way, so be it. But remember, you'll bear the consequences of not heeding your mother's advice," she remarked resignedly. "If you're willing to accept that, then do as you please." So I followed her directive by stepping into my father's company, inadvertently widening the chasm between my mother and me. Conversely, my bond with my father deepened as we spent more time together. Reflecting on it now, I realize my mother wasn't pleased with the turn of events. Upon joining my father's company, he invested considerable effort in my training, which, unbeknownst to me, was driven by his declining health. It took him nearly half a year to acquaint me with the intricacies of the job before he collapsed at our workplace, swiftly whisked away to the hospital. Over the next 5 years, he valiantly battled his illness. "Amy, how's the company faring without your dad?" my mother inquired, her concern veiled by skepticism. "It's challenging, but everyone's rallying behind me. Dad entrusted me with everything I need," I replied confidently. "Well, as long as that's the case, just ensure you don't leave the company to ruin as the second generation," she cautioned, her words tinged with apprehension. "You lack any genuine interest or affection for the company. You're merely preoccupied with others' perceptions," I retorted, disheartened by her lack of faith. During my father's illness, our disagreements were frequent. Despite his weakening state, he made sporadic visits to the company, emphasizing its significance. "These employees in this company are invaluable treasures to me, but I must relinquish my hold on them," he confessed, his voice laced with emotion. "Amy, I've witnessed your dedication over the years. I trust you to safeguard this place and everyone here. I don't know if I can emulate you, Dad, but I'll strive to uphold your legacy," I pledged solemnly. From that day forth, the mantle of leadership was bestowed upon me. With my father mostly confined to the hospital, my days were consumed with the company's affairs, leaving little time for homecomings. I prioritized visiting him regularly, carving out time amidst my busy schedule. My mother, on the other hand, fulfilled only the basic duties, such as delivering changes of clothes to him. Even that seemed to inconvenience her. I couldn't help but wonder about her feelings towards my father. Did she lack any sense of gratitude or compassion for his illness? The thought left me feeling sorry for him, recalling the sacrifices he made for me during my childhood, a time when my mother's affection remained elusive. Despite my exhaustion, I made a concerted effort to visit him as often as possible, a routine that persisted for about a year until he peacefully passed away in his sleep. Amidst the whirlwind of tasks that followed, I barely had a moment to grieve. My mother, oblivious to my emotional turmoil, expected me to handle everything from funeral arrangements to hospital paperwork. Realistically, I knew I couldn't rely on my mother, who had never ventured beyond the confines of our home. So I silently assumed responsibility for the myriad tasks. The day after the funeral, my mother broached the subject. "Amy, now that the funeral is over, you've settled down, haven't you?" she inquired. With a heavy heart, I accepted the reality of the situation. "Please leave this house. I've just inherited 200 million yen, so I have no use for you anymore." "Thank you," she declared, as though it were a mere formality. Her words stung, but I had anticipated them. Further discussion seemed futile. Did she truly believe that wealth could replace familial bonds and absolve her of responsibility? With a multitude of questions swirling in my mind, I made the decision to depart. The next day, I arranged for the sale of all belongings associated with me, leaving my mother utterly surprised at the speed of my departure. I had meticulously planned my departure, but I harbored a secret from my mother. Despite her claim of inheriting 200 million yen, my father had entrusted all financial matters to me, designating me as the sole inheritor. Not a single yen remained for my mother, a decision my father made adamantly while he was still in good health. "Your mother lacks the understanding of money management or prudent spending. I want you to provide her with monthly household expenses," he instructed me. "If she receives a lump sum, she's likely to squander it immediately. If she protests, refuse to give her a penny." Though my father's last words were spoken in jest, he handed me an SD card containing a video message addressed to my mother. While I never envisioned showing it to her, recent events suggested its necessity might arise sooner than later. After my departure, I anticipated my mother would reach out to me, but her summons came sooner than expected. "Come home immediately," she demanded over the phone. "I'm working, Mom. What's the matter?" I replied, feeling a pang of annoyance. "I just need to talk to you." "Please come quickly," she insisted. With a sigh, I reluctantly headed back to our family home, clutching the SD card in my hand. As soon as my mother laid eyes on me, she launched into accusations. "You absconded with all of your father's inheritance, didn't you? I knew something was amiss when you left so abruptly. Hand over your father's inheritance to me now," she demanded, her greed palpable. "How selfish can you be? You can't even fulfill your duties as a mother," I retorted, my frustration simmering. In response, I silently extended the SD card to her. Confused, she inspected it. "What's this?" she queried. "I suppose you don't even know how to watch this," I remarked, masking my disappointment. I retrieved my laptop, inserted the SD card, and played the video. On the screen, my father appeared, as vibrant as I remembered him. I couldn't help but wonder how my mother would react to this video letter. Silently, I exited the room, leaving her to watch it alone. I had never witnessed my mother defy my father before, but now, in the wake of his passing, would his words resonate with her? Upon returning to the room, I found my mother in tears, her emotions laid bare. I was taken aback, my mother, shedding tears over a video of my late father. I was intrigued by the contents of the video letter he had left for her, but hesitated to watch it myself. Consequently, I remained clueless about the cause of her tears. "Mom, are you okay?" I inquired, concern lacing my voice. "Yes, I'll be fine. For now, I understand. I'll adhere to your father's wishes and entrust everything to you from now on. Please, go home for today. Call me once you've had time to gather yourself," she replied, her tone subdued. Sensing her desire for privacy, I left promptly, pondering over how my father had managed to silence my mother. Questions swirled in my mind as I made my way home. Nearly a month passed without any communication from my mother, prompting concern to gnaw at me. During my lunch break, I decided to pay a visit to my parents' house, hoping to check on her. However, she wasn't home. That evening, I returned once more, relieved to find the lights on. Sorry for dropping in unexpectedly. I came by this afternoon, but you weren't home, so I grew concerned. I explained upon seeing her. I'm sorry, I was out for my part-time job during the day. My mother explained upon my return. A part-time job? I echoed incredulously. My understanding of my mother painted her as someone vehemently opposed to work. How had it come to this? Didn't you watch that video? It was a video letter addressed to you. I retorted, baffled by her sudden change in behavior. You can take it home. You should watch it too, Hammy. Can I watch it? I asked, extending the SD card to her. Very well, she acquiesced, passing it back to me. Feeling a twinge of apprehension, I returned to the office and settled at my father's desk. With a deep breath, I played the video. Honey, if you're watching this, it means you've not been able to communicate with Amy. First of all, thank you so much for helping me raise Amy until now. Without you, I don't think I could have managed the company while bringing up Amy. My father's voice resonated through the room. As his words continued, a sense of unease crept over me. Then he uttered something unexpected, something that shook me to my core. You've taken care of Amy, even though she is not your child, and I have nothing but gratitude for you. You've stood by my side for so many years, but as a result, you've given up on your dreams and have reached your age without earning your own living. For that, I take responsibility because I have allowed you to live a life of luxury. I'm sure you'll be in trouble when I'm gone. I'm not my mother's child, I blurted out, the realization hitting me like a ton of bricks. But then it clicked. Despite the lack of overt affection, she had cared for me every day, doing the bare minimum for a child who wasn't her own. Who was this person? I didn't register our marriage because you told me you felt bad for your sister, so I ended up supporting your living and didn't do anything else. I'm sorry, but once I'm gone, I worry about the rest of your life. There's no one to support you, and I've taken your life away. I sat in disbelief as my father spoke, his words flowing with unexpected clarity. It was all news to me, his concerns, his regrets, his hopes for our future. Throughout the night, I grappled with the weight of his revelations before confronting my mother the following day. Mom, I watched the video from Dad yesterday. You know it all now, I began, my voice tinged with a mixture of confusion and realization. I raised you because I was asked to. That's all, she confessed, her tone heavy with the weight of untold truths. What happened to my biological mother? I pressed, seeking clarity amidst the swirling chaos of newfound information. You were the child of my sister and your father, she explained somberly. My sister died right after giving birth to you, and I promised your distressed father that I would help raise Amy. I would become your mother. With her revelation, everything fell into place, even the parts I had previously only imagined. I learned of my mother's sacrifice, how she had set aside her own dreams to fulfill her promise to my father. I recalled how my mother used to work in a diner, her vibrant spirit and dedication palpable. Her dream had been to own her own diner, yet when she chose to become my mother, she shelved that dream. However, inspired by my father's words and prompted by the memory of her deferred dream, my mother made a decision. She resolved to reclaim that dream, embarking on a journey to pursue it once more. Currently, she is undergoing training as a part-timer, determined to turn her dream of owning a diner into reality. I should have done this earlier. Working is fun and suits me. I had no idea, so it's my fault you didn't work. I'm really sorry for not knowing anything, my mother admitted, her tone filled with regret. It's not your fault, Amy. I made the decision myself. But I'm not good with children, so I couldn't handle you well. I'm the one who caused you trouble, she continued, taking responsibility for her actions. As we conversed, I realized it was the first time we had such an open dialogue. At this stage in my life, I finally felt like I had come to understand my mother a bit better. Our conversations became more frequent, leading us to a decision: to use the money left by my father to fund the opening of her shop. Once she started working, my mother became somewhat more humble. She hesitated when the topic of funds for the shop came up, a behavior that would have been unimaginable not too long ago. While maintaining my regular job, I also assisted with the opening of her diner. This brought me into frequent contact with my mother, fostering a newfound relationship between us. Regarding living expenses, she insisted on managing them with her own income, refusing to accept help from my father's inheritance, promising that you'll tell me if you're struggling. After all, Dad trusted me to take care of you, I urged her. I'll be fine living on my own. It doesn't cost that much. But in terms of my diner's expenses, she trailed off, her determination evident. I'll be relying on you. Of course, I'm looking forward to it too, so do your best, my mother encouraged, her eyes filled with hope and anticipation. After many years, we finally became a real family, and now we are living harmoniously. She isn't my birth mother, and perhaps it was just the right time for me to learn this truth. Your diner is finally going to open tomorrow. Your dream is coming true, I remarked, filled with pride as I watched her dedication. Seeing you work so hard at that company reminded me of my own dreams when I was younger. I believe that's why I've made it this far. It's all thanks to you and your father. Thank you so much, Mom, I expressed my gratitude, feeling a deep sense of appreciation. Promise me to always be my mom, Amy, she implored, her voice filled with sincerity. From now on, let's get along even better than before. After all, we only have each other, I replied, feeling a newfound sense of closeness. Upon my father's death, the truth was revealed, and I accepted the reality of our situation. Deciding to live on with just my mother and me, I contemplated moving back to my hometown and living together with her again. I don't cook, so my mother is concerned about my poor diet and is supportive of me coming back, I explained, feeling touched by her care. My father would probably be surprised that we're getting along so well. His house, company, and inheritance that he left behind. I'll protect them at all costs while continuing to get along with my mother in order to become a real family. I vowed, determined to honor my father's legacy. We visited the graves of my father and my biological mother, my mother's older sister, to give our daily life updates. After going through the process of adoption, I finally became registered as my mother's daughter, forging a bond that transcended bloodlines.